One very common transformation that is used in flight simulation is called the direction-cosine formulation. Now, we actually are not going to use this formulation in our development here for our flight simulator, but I'm covering it because it's actually widely used in the aerospace community. It's a very common method for describing the orientation of an aircraft. And one of the benefits of this is that it does not suffer from gimbal lock. So let's just talk about what it is, because you will probably run across it in your career at some point. So so we have vector components, Vx, Vy, Vz, that we want in the body fixed coordinate system. And we're going to multiply the vector Vx, Vy, Vz in the Earth fixed coordinate system. So that's that sub F, that's the Earth fixed coordinate system. There's some transformation matrix that we could multiply this vector by in order to get it in body fixed coordinate system. And so we're going to call the components of this just C11, C12, C13, C21, C22, C23, C31, C32, and C33. Okay, so this transformation matrix has 9 components, and you can actually create a direction cosine matrix. That's what this matrix is called, the direction cosine matrix. You can create one of these matrices from any of the Euler angle formulations that we've already discussed. So for example, here's what is commonly used in the aeronautics community. Now, this is actually the inverse of what we're talking about here, because in this one, we're going from body fix to earth fix. But if you take the inverse of this matrix, which is also the transpose, then you could go the opposite direction. So anyway, I'm just showing this as an example, though. This has 9 components. And we could evaluate the actual number here. You know, if we knew the orientation at some point in time, we could compute the actual number that would go in each of these 9 locations. And that would give us a 9 component matrix that is used to transform a vector from one coordinate system to the other coordinate system. Okay. Now, there's no real convention. Some people name these 9 components this way when we're transferring from earth fix to body fix. Of course, the inverse of this matrix, or the transpose, can be used to go from body fix to earth fix. And some people use that instead when they order these components here. So anyway, you just have to be aware of the convention that you're looking at, or what's being used in the particular code or documentation that you're looking at when you're applying the direction cosine formulation, because there's no real standard. But this is probably more commonly done, where they talk about going from earth fix to body fix, and then they label them in this order here. So these 9 components, okay? Okay, so at any given time, we can compute, or at some initial time, for example, we could compute the 9 values here in this matrix, and then that would give us help us transfer this vector from one coordinate system to the other, but it's only good for that moment in time, or until this transformation matrix changes. You know, the values in here change, which is going to happen once it changes, its bank angle or azimuth angle or elevation angle, you know, any of the Euler angles here, or its orientation. When it changes, then this matrix changes. Well, you can use Poisson's kinematic equations. Let me write that down. So this is Poisson's kinematic equations to evaluate how the direction cosine matrix changes as a function of rotation rates on board the aircraft. So you can write this, and this is not the, usually it's written in vector form, but we're going to write it here in this form here. So the change, so we've got C.11, C.12, C.13, C dot 2-1, C dot 2-2, C dot 2-3, C dot 3-1, C dot 3-2, C dot 3-3. Okay, so this is the change in the direction cosine matrix here is equal to 0 R minus Q minus R 0 P and Q minus P and 0 multiplied by the current direction cosine matrix. So C11, C12, C13, C21, C22, C23, 31, C32, and C33. Okay, so if I know the current matrix, or the current direction cosine matrix, and I also know the rotation rates on board the aircraft, P, Q, and R, so our roll, pitch, and yaw rates, then I can multiply that here and get the change in my direction cosine matrix. Okay, so this is how a lot of these codes do it, is they actually they're integrating this forward in time as well. Their direction cosine matrix is getting updated every time step, just like every other state of the aircraft, and they're integrating this equation forward in time, just like we've talked about the other equations that those get integrated forward in time. And so you can do that, and this is a widely used method, and it has no gimbal lock, which is really valuable. In fact, let me just write that here. This is no gimbal lock. That's one of the big reasons to use it. You know, one of the main reasons that it's used. Anyway, this can be used just fine. Now, this is a little bit more computationally expensive than the quaternion formulation that we're going to talk about later. So we're, again, not going to apply this because quaternions, in my opinion, are a little bit more elegant. But this is something that can be done. Now, we have 9 variables here that we're keeping track of. These are the 9 components of this matrix. And we're keeping track of their current values and then computing the change in those values and integrating forward. So we have 9 values here, but actually we only have 3 degrees of freedom. Remember, we're using these 9 values to represent the Euler angles. And there's only 3 degrees of freedom that are there to represent that exists to represent this orientation. And so that means we actually have 6 levels of redundancy here. Actually, we have 6 redundancy equations or relations. So let's just talk about what those are really quickly. Because this transformation is proper orthogonal, that means that, so we're going to call this matrix here C. And because it's proper orthogonal, that means that the inverse of C must be equal to the transpose of C. Okay, and so if you apply that constraint, that gives us 6 equations here that must be satisfied in order for this to be true. So I'll just write these down here. So that means that C11 squared plus C21 squared plus C31 squared must equal 1. C12 squared plus C22 squared plus C32 squared has to equal 1. C13 squared plus C23 squared plus C33 squared equals 1. And those are 3 of the equations. And then we have 3 more equations here. C11 times C12 plus C21 times C22 plus C31 times C32 equals 0. C11 times C13 plus C21 times C23 plus C31 times C33 equals 0. And finally, C12 times C13 plus C22, C23 plus C32 times C33 equals 0. Okay, so these are called the redundancy relations. Okay, and all of these have to be true for this to be proper orthogonal. So so as we're integrating this this system of equations forward in time here, you'll get errors that build up in this. And so these equations can be used to kind of get rid of some of the error. You know, as you get as you integrate forward in time this matrix, then it's going to become its orthogonality may not hold completely just because of numerical integration errors. And so you can use these six equations over here to get rid of that orthogonality error. And we're going to talk about that same type of phenomenon with the quaternion formulation. It has a similar property, and we'll use the something to keep updating the quaternion to make sure that it's proper orthogonal as well. But anyway, so this is the direction cosine formulation. Like I said, it's widely used, and so you should be familiar with it. And hopefully, if you ever run into it, there's enough here that you can understand what's going on, and work with it. You know, whatever, however they're using it.